Half a day, students. My name is Lieutenant Governor Josh Tenorio. As we battle this COVID-19 outbreak, I want you to know that together, Governor Liu and I are working very hard
to do everything within our power to keep our island safe from COVID-19. I want to begin by thanking you all for staying home and staying safe during the current COVID-19 pandemic. Let's continue to do our part by practicing good hygiene, social distancing, and staying home.
It's not easy, but we
can do this.
This means listening to your parents.
We're all in this together.
Wash your hands for at least 20 seconds and wash your hands frequently.
I know you understand why we had to close schools down for the rest of the school year.
We will get
I want you to know that your safety,
to our parents,
the safety
the governor
of your families,
and I know how important
the safety
it is that we stay diligent in our efforts to keep our students warm, healthy, and safe.
As you know, you for we have in already provided a set of distance learning resources
I would also like
that
to
are now on our website at
www.gdoe.net. For their hard work,
now we're taking it to the next level
for their
with the
commitment
help of
to our students
public broadcasting service.
To our students, we
better
hope that you enjoy PBS University
next week on Monday, April 20th, we will be launching PBS University, which will contain televised weekly lessons developed by our teachers and staff. These will be simple but effective.
PBS University is a program by the Guam Department of Education, PBS Guam, and in conjunction with public school teachers to create lessons that students will be able to easily follow. With the aim of helping students continue their learning at home, providing their parents and students with a unique educational experience. PBS University and PBS Guam.
Half a day. My name is John Fernandez. I want to close by just thanking those people on the front lines of the COVID-19.
I want to begin by thanking you all,
our healthcare professionals, including our
during the current COVID-19
school nurses and social workers.
Let's continue to do
our
law enforcement
practicing good hygiene,
our very own
social distancing,
student attendance officers.
I know it's not easy, but we can do this.
Our principals and school staff
are this together,
along with Sodexo employees.
I know you understand why we had to close schools down for the rest of the school year.
I
want you to know that your safety, the safety of your families, and the safety of employees, nonprofit. And
but let's not give up on
needy
teaching families.
And
our
teachers and staff,
we have already provided a set of distance learning resources
that are now on our website at www.keepapositiveattitude.net.
Keep learning.
Now we're taking it to the next level with the help of Guam Public Broadcasting Service, better known as PBS.
Stay safe.
Where on earth are we traveling today? Hey guys, Ms. Torres here. We're going to visit the 7 continents and 5 oceans. Are you ready for a trip around the world? Our journey begins with those large land masses called continents. I wonder what's our first destination? Asia. It's the largest continent. It has 48 countries. Mount Everest, the highest mountain in the world, is there. And more people live here than on any other continent. And on most world maps, it's located right at the top right. Next stop, Africa. It's the second largest continent with 54 countries. It has the largest desert, the Sahara, and the longest river in the world, the Nile. But what's most important, it produces the most chocolate. And where is it located on most world maps? Right smack in the middle. Europe's up next. Europe is the second smallest continent. It has 50 countries. And if you're a tourist, I bet you've been to France. It's the number one tourist destination. And if you want to find Europe, look at the top middle of most world maps. Where are we off to next? Australia. It's our smallest continent, but did you also know it's a country? Yep, it's the only country and continent together. Did you also know it's the largest island in the world? And it has more sheep than humans. Bah, bah. Imagine hearing that every day. And if you look at most world maps, where do you find it? On the bottom right. Our next stop, Antarctica. It's our 5th largest continent. And although it's completely covered in ice, bet you didn't know it's a desert. Yep. And in the winter, it stays dark. And in the summer, the sun doesn't set. And if you want to find it on most world maps, where do you think you're going to look? You're right. All the way at the very bottom. South America, our next stop. It's our 4th largest continent with 12 countries. It has the world's largest waterfall called Angel Falls. It's also the wettest continent, probably because it's mostly made of rainforests. And Brazil is the largest producer of coffee. Pretty sure your mom and dad are happy about that. And if you look at most world maps, where do you find it? On the bottom left. And our last destination, North America, which has 23 countries. You don't believe me? Look it up. It's our third largest continent. It has all the major biomes. Those are the natural habitats. A desert, some grasslands, forests, an aquatic habitat, and even a tundra. And where would you find it? Right on the top left of most world maps. So, that brings us to the end of our travels through the continents. So what's up next? You guessed it. Our continents quiz of the day. And Rachel's going to give it a try. Let's see how she does. Rachel did a great job with our continents quiz of the day, but we're not done yet. We did say we're going to visit the seven continents and five oceans. So here we are, large bodies of water that are called oceans. Here we come. First stop, the Arctic Ocean. It's the smallest ocean on our Earth. It's also the most shallow, which means it's not too deep. And if you look at the map, it's located way up north, which means, yep, most of the time it's covered in ice. And what might you see there? Penguins and walruses. The Atlantic Ocean's our next stop. It's located between North America and Africa, as you can see on the map. It's our second largest ocean, and it covers 20% of the Earth's surface. What might you see there? Dolphins and turtles. The Indian Ocean? It's between Africa and Australia and right below Asia. It also covers 20% of the Earth's surface. It's our third largest ocean, and you're probably going to run into some seals and sea cows there. The Southern Ocean, that's up next, and it's way down south near Antarctica. It's also our coldest ocean. It's the fourth largest, and it's home to emperor penguins and giant squids. And our last ocean of the day, where we live, our island of Guam is right in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. It's located between North America and Asia. It's also the largest ocean on Earth. It covers 30% of the surface. And it has the deepest place called the Mariana Trench. And if you ever go out on the water, you might see some dolphins and maybe a sea lion. So here's Rachel again. She's going to try out our oceans quiz of the day. Wow. I know we did a quick trip with our oceans, but Rachel did a great job. And here we got it. Continents on Earth wrap coming right at ya. Continents take space. Land mass is in their place. Some are big, some are small. Let's get ready to learn them all. Australia, the smallest land. It has more sheep than humans. Europe comes next at number 6. France is the place to visit. Antarctica is way down south, and it's number 5. It's very cold with seals and whales and covered with blankets of ice. South America's number 4. with rainforest galore. Number three is North America. Many countries call it home. It's the only one of the continents to have all the major biomes. Africa, the hottest land, it has to be number two. It has the Sahara and the Nile and produces the most chocolate too. Last of all is number one. Asia takes top spot. It's the largest continent on our earth where the population's a lot. Continents take space. Land mass is in their place. Some are big, some are small. We're at the end. Hope you learn them all.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back to PBS University. I'm so glad you're here. Today, I'm at one of my favorite grocery stores because I need to get some groceries so that I can make dinner tonight. But before I head in, I've got a couple of things that I need to do to make sure that I continue to practice safe physical distancing. First, I made myself a list so I know exactly what I'm after. And second, I have my mask. So I'm gonna put this on and we're gonna head inside and see what we can find. Are you ready? Let's go find some groceries. First item on my list, pasta sauce and pasta. Item number two, I need some ground beef. And now we're off for some fresh produce. I think I found everything on my list. Time to check out. Well, I finally made it home with my groceries, but I forgot to mention one important thing. My budget. Nobody wants to spend all that time in the grocery store putting groceries in a shopping cart only to find out that they don't have enough money to pay for it. That's so disappointing. My budget for today's grocery trip was $50, and I'm gonna need your help to see if I bought everything I needed and stayed under budget. We'll start with the first items on my list, pasta sauce and pasta. The cost of these items is pretty easy to calculate because we know exactly how much each item costs. I bought two bottles of pasta sauce that cost $4.49 each and two boxes of pasta that cost $2.79 each. To find out how much each item costs, we need to multiply the cost of one item times two. To calculate our total, our math problem would look like this. Multiplying with decimals works exactly the same as multiplying without decimals, except for one extra step at the end. For now, we are going to ignore that decimal point. To begin, we multiply the numbers in the ones place. 9 times 2 equals 18. But I can't write 18 here because I can only have one digit in each place. 18 has 1 10 and 8 ones. So the 8 goes here in the ones place, and the 1 goes here in the tens place. Now we multiply the numbers in the tens place. 4 times 2 is 8. Remember the 1 we put up here? We add it to our product. 8 plus 1 is 9. I'll put the 9 here. Now we move on to the hundreds place. 4 times 2 is 8. Let's go back to that decimal point. I'll count how many digits are to the right of the decimal point in the problem. 1, 2. Then, starting at the ones place in the answer, I'll count that same number of digits. 1, 2. This is where my decimal point belongs. My two jars of pasta sauce cost $8.98. I'll use the same process to calculate the cost of my pasta. What do you do when you don't know the exact price of an item? There are many items in grocery stores that don't have exact prices. Things like meat or fresh fruits and vegetables. These items are usually sold by the pound, and you would calculate their cost exactly the same way you calculate the cost of an item you know the exact price of. But you'll need two pieces of very important information. You'll need to know how much the store charges per pound and how many pounds your item weighs. Well, I don't know about you, but I've never seen a price with four digits after the decimal point. All prices end at the hundredths place. When you have extra digits after the hundredths place, we look in the thousandths place and we use our rounding rules. I know that if I have a number five or higher, that the number to the left needs to round up. So this seven should become an eight, and my ground beef costs $9.78. I use my multiplication skills to calculate the cost of the onions and the red bell peppers that I bought. Multiplication works for these items because both of them weighed more than 1 pound. But what do you do if you buy something that doesn't weigh 1 pound? I bought some mushrooms, but I only bought half a pound. Well, for that, you're gonna need division, and I like box division. I bought half a pound of mushrooms. That means I took 1 pound and divided it into two equal parts. So I'm using the number two outside the boxes. Then I put $6.49 in the boxes because that's how much the store charges per pound of mushrooms. To use box division, you take the number outside the boxes and divide it into the number inside the boxes. So how many times can two go into six? Three. I'm going to write that number on top of the box. Now, I'll multiply 3 times 2. I know that answer is also 6. Now I can move on to the next box. How many times can 2 go into 4? 2. 2 times 2 is 4. Now we can move on to the next box. How many times can 2 go into 9? 9. That's too many. I think the answer is 4. Now, if I multiply 4 times 2, I get 8. This number comes up here. How many times can 2 go into 1? 0. This number comes back up. And this cycle would continue and continue. But I've already found a whole number and the next two digits after the decimal. So I know my mushrooms cost me $3.24. Well, now that we've calculated the cost of all the items I purchased, it's time to add them up to see if I managed to stick to my budget. When adding or subtracting numbers with decimals, it's important to keep your decimals in a straight line. I added up all the items that I bought for my dinner, and it came to $35.11. I did not spend more than my $50 budget. I think I did a pretty good job. Thanks for helping me calculate the cost of all my groceries.
Mom, I'm hungry.
I guess I better get to cooking dinner. Thanks for watching. We'll see you again soon. Bye!
Hafede, welcome to PBS University. I'm Mr. Borja. For today's science lesson, we're going to be observing balanced and unbalanced forces. You know, a big part of science is just making observations. A good friend of mine, who happens to be a scientist, said that science is basically people saying, huh? That's weird. I wonder why that happened. So, as we're going on with our lesson today, I want you to constantly observe what's going on and ask yourself, I wonder why that happened. So to help you do this, I want to introduce you to a simple chart that you can use to record what you see and the questions that you have about what you're seeing. Let's make a notice wonder chart. So you're going to need something to write with, preferably a pencil, and to keep organized, it's best to do this in a notebook, like this one. So all you're going to do is take your page and fold it in half lengthwise. On the top left side, I want you to write the word notice. Now on the top right side, I want you to write the word wonder. Oh, and don't forget to put a title. Observing forces. That's it. You're all ready to use it. Okay, now let's put those charts to work. As you watch this short video clip, on your charts, write down some things you notice and anything you might wonder about. Try to focus on things that might have to do with force. What are some things that you noticed? You might have noticed that there were some children playing in a yard, and there was a boy who was swinging a hula hoop around, and a girl running around. Did you notice a ball just sitting at the top of a slide? And the girl goes over and she moves the ball off of the slide. Okay, now, what are some of the things that you might have been wondering about? Maybe you're wondering, how did the ball get there in the first place? Or what made the ball stop? And maybe some of you were even just wondering, what does any of this have to do with balanced and unbalanced force in the first place? And that's okay, because, well, first of all, what is force? A simple way to think of it is force is the energy applied to an object that affects its motion, like what the girl did to move the ball off the slide. Now, what kind of force did she apply or use? Today, we'll look at two ways to apply force and the ways that they can affect an object's motion. Force can be applied by either pushing or pulling, and if you push or pull with enough force, you can change an object's motion. Or can you? It's important to know that there are always forces acting on all objects. Like, what's that one force that we all know? Yeah, that's it. That force is called gravity. And for today, let's think of gravity as a force that pulls objects down. Now, even when it seems like an object is still or not moving, there are always forces, like gravity, working on the object. And the reason why it doesn't move is because there are other equal forces working on the object as well. We call these forces balanced forces. Balanced forces are two equal forces acting on an object in opposite directions. Let's take a look at an example of balanced forces. Oh, and don't forget to use your charts while you're watching. Okay, so what did we just observe? We saw two kids playing tug-of-war. And it kind of looked like it ended in a tie, huh? So how can we explain that it was in fact a tie? Think about that for a sec. Well, as they were pulling, it looked like neither one was really moving, right? Or the flag in the middle just wasn't moving. Like we said, when there are two equal forces acting on an object in opposite directions, like the kids pulling on the rope, those forces are balanced forces. And this results in no motion or no change in motion. And in the case of a tug-of-war game, a tie. In order to change an object's motion, you have to apply an unbalanced force. That means that the force has to be moving in one direction, and it has to be strong enough to move that object. A force can also be moving in opposite directions if one of the forces is greater than the other one. Here are some examples of unbalanced forces. I'm sure you noticed the boy pulling a cart and the girl kicking a soccer ball. And you notice that the force was being applied in one direction. These are unbalanced forces. And unbalanced forces can change the motion of an object, like a cart or a soccer ball. We've been focusing on science for the last few minutes, but after this lesson, I really want you to continue thinking like a scientist. Take those notebooks with you when you're out with your family and make more notice wonder charts. They can be about anything, not just forces. Maybe you notice and wonder about the moon, or you notice that your fruits and vegetables are going bad. Make a chart about anything that grabs your attention, but I challenge you to take a look at the simple things. Take a deeper look into them and ask yourself, why did that happen? Hey, thanks for hanging out today. Stay curious, stay safe, and see you next time.
Hi there, this is Ms. Powers for PBS University. Oh, I'm your 3rd through 5th grade teacher. Sorry, you just caught me eating my snack. Oh, what was it? It's apples and peanut butter. Oh, yeah, that is a pretty healthy snack. Well, that's good, because today we're gonna talk about nutrition. And you may be asking yourself, what is nutrition? Nutrition is the process of providing or obtaining the food that you need for proper growth and functioning. And to get the right nutrition, you need to have a balanced diet. Who here's seen the poster in the cafeteria with my plate? Yes, it's the one with the round circle that symbolizes your plate, and it shows the different proportion or portion sizes of what you should be eating in a day. So half of it is divided into vegetables and fruits, that's right. So that should be half, or the majority of what you eat during the day. And then another quarter is divided into grains, and which is gonna be your breads, rice, cereals, oatmeal, and whole grains are best if they're available. And then the next quarter is proteins or meats. It could be any kind of meat, seafood, poultry, tofu, beans, anything with protein in it. And the very last portion is dairy, which could be any kind of milk product, including yogurt, cheese, milk, or it could be any product with calcium. For example, dark leafy greens or a handful of almonds or fortified plant-based milk with calcium in it. Because I know some people cannot drink dairy or consume it. So if you consume something from all of those categories several times a day, then you will have balanced nutrition. And if it's hard for you to remember that much, you can think of foods as sometimes foods and anytime foods. So can anybody guess what would be an anytime food? That's right, vegetables and fruits. You can have those anytime. And what about a sometimes food? Oh yes, a candy bar or potato chips or any kind of fried food. Yeah, those would just be sometimes because they're not necessarily providing good nutrition for you, but it's okay to have them every once in a while as a special treat, like a birthday cake, right? So let's look at an examples of fruits and vegetables that are here on island. I got most of these from my yard. Some I got from local farmers. So let's look at some options here. We have papaya, star apple, mango, banana, star fruit, manzanita, pumpkin tips, cucumbers, tomatoes. Yeah, there's lots of great things here. Does anybody see something that they like to eat? I bet. I love all of these things. So if you look at the plate, though, what do you notice about it? About what all the things on the plate? Yes, they're colorful. That's right. That's why, I don't know if you've ever heard the saying, eat a rainbow. Yeah, every day, if you eat a rainbow, then you'll almost be guaranteed to have good nutrition. So keep that in mind. But let's talk about something else that keeps you healthy. And it's called exercise. Exercise is important because it helps you maintain a healthy weight, and it also aids in preventing type 2 diabetes and heart disease now and later in life. It's recommended that you get 60 minutes of exercise a day, and to do that, you need to find something that's interesting for you. Besides being on screen time, you really have to limit your screen time to ensure that you go outside and exercise. I know I have to do the same thing for me. So, what kind of exercises do you like? Do you like baseball, swimming, basketball, riding your bike, dancing? Oh, yeah, I think a lot of you guys like dancing, right? Okay, so we can get some exercise by following a Zumba workout online or learning a new dance. But today, we're gonna get some exercise with Kids Bop and following along their dance video. So follow along with me. Get ready, stand up, and let's exercise.
It's keeping me awake. Wonder why I feel this type of way. Like I never knew that I could fly. Finally got my chance to reach the sky. Now I wanna go wild, so I'm gonna go wild. No stop for me now, no stop for me now. Cause I'm gonna go wild, cause I'm gonna go wild. Wave on the clouds, no one's gonna stop me now. I'm gonna have the best time ever. Gonna have the best time ever. I'm gonna have the best time ever. Come and take my hand. Gotta say that I'm your biggest fan. but you won't believe the crazy things. It's a brand new world that you gotta see. Now I wanna go wild, so I'm gonna go wild. No stop for me now, no stop for me now.
Actually, I hope you had the best time ever. So make sure you eat a rainbow and exercise for at least 60 minutes a day to take great care of your body. Until next time, bye.
Hafaday Guam, welcome to PBS University. I'm Mrs. Ryan Pegorito, your third, fourth, and fifth grade reading teacher. I was just thinking about you as I was taking my morning walk. I had an unexpected visitor. Would you like to meet her? Great. Everyone, say hello to Holly. Holly is a reptile animal known as a monitor lizard. In the Chamorro language, she's called Hilitay. I was so excited to learn about Holly. I got all these books about reptiles. Sometimes reading can be so overwhelming. Did you know there are so many types of books or styles of writing? How do you pronounce this word? I know it looks funny, right? Like Genri? Genre. It's pronounced genre. Genre is a French word that means style. So instead of asking what type of book you're reading, you can say, what genre is that book you are reading? Fancy smancy, huh? Genre can be grouped into two groups. Fiction, that means made up or imaginary, and nonfiction, meaning true or factual. How can you tell the difference between the two? Well, fiction comes from the word fictitious. That means made up. And non in the nonfiction tells me that it's not fiction. There are so many types of fiction and nonfiction. If I want to learn more about reptiles, What genre shall I read? Awesome! Nonfiction. Let's read our objectives. I can define genre, fiction, and nonfiction. I can identify features of a nonfiction text. While there are two genres of books, fiction and nonfiction, there are so many subgenres of each. Nonfiction has several subgenres, like biography, autobiography, articles, and subject-specific nonfiction. If I want to learn about reptiles, then it's important to know about nonfiction text features. These are things that help you make sense of what you're reading and is most helpful to you. Nonfiction books like this one has a title. A title is what the book is called. Normally, it's on the cover or the top of the page of an article. This book also has a subtitle. Subtitle gives more information about the book. If we open the book, we can also find the table of contents. The table of contents tells you what page each chapter or section begins. Nonfiction books may also have photographs or illustrations. These are great visuals and make reading nonfiction text so much fun. Sometimes you can find captions underneath them. Captions give more information about a picture. Remember, understanding text features helps you make sense about what you're reading and which information is most helpful to you. In nonfiction books, you may also find diagrams. Diagrams are drawings that show part of something or how it works. Diagrams have labels that teach the important components. You can also find cutaways and cross sections. This allows you to see inside something by dissolving part of a wall, or to see all the layers of an object by bisecting it for viewing. Charts, graphs, tables organize information to make it easier to read and understand. You can also find maps. Maps help the reader locate a place. You can also find timelines. Timelines show the order of when things happen and are often used with historical events. Remember, understanding text features helps you make sense about what you're reading and which information is most helpful to you. Nonfiction writers often use bold or italic letters. Sometimes these words can be found in the glossary. The glossary identifies important vocabulary words for students and gives their definitions. The glossary can be found at the end of the book along with the index. The words in the index are usually listed in alphabetical order. A, B, C, D, E, F, G. This is where you find the glossary. Whew! Writers do so much to help us find what we need and make sense of what we're reading. Let's review. Do you remember the text features of a nonfiction text? There's title, subtitle, table of contents, photograph, illustration, caption, diagram, labels, cutaway, chart, graph, table, map, timeline, bold, italic, glossary, and index. Remember, these are text features we can find in nonfiction books and articles. There are also two types of books or styles of writing. Do you remember what it's called? That's right. Genre. Do you remember what the two genres are? If a story is made up or imaginary, which genre is this? That's right, fiction. And if a story is true or factual, which genre is this? Right, nonfiction. You guys are awesome. So I found out that monitor lizards are carnivores. That means they eat meat, but they sure do like their fruits. Do you think Holly would like a watermelon? Let's go find her. Do you want to help me look for Holly? Holly! Holly, where are you? Do you see her? I don't see her anywhere. What's that? Wait a minute. That's not Holly. That's right, chicken. That's BB-8. BB-8, what are you doing here? Wow, you're all such amazing readers. Thank you for reminding me how to find information in a nonfiction text. Now I'm going to research about Holly, our monitor lizard. Bye.